Prime Minister Ásgrímsson, ladies and gentlemen, shortly before Christmas in 1958, a few Icelandic fishermen were sailing their new boat from Stralsund in what was then the GGR towards Copenhagen. The route was not long, but in fact, it was a journey between two worlds, leaving behind a gloomy land with little regret. Ahead lay a whole different world, in fact. Reflecting on the circumstances, they suddenly realized the great difference between the two systems. On one hand, a system of stagnation and closed society. On the other hand, a system of progress and openness. These Icelandic fishermen were fortunate. They had a choice and could leave the communist system where they only had stayed as guests for a short period. Such a choice was not an option for those living in east of the Iron Curtain, as Winston Churchill so well termed the dividing line between the free world and the communist countries in his famous speech from 1946. The Berlin Wall was an iconic symbol of communism. It was a tangible example of defensive move of a despotic society in order to contain its citizens. But what kind of a social system existed behind the Berlin Wall and the Iron Curtain? What were its roots and what was the reason for such a society? One needs to look back to 1922, when the USSR was established after the victory of the Bolsheviks. The order created was based on the Marxist ideology as expressed in the writings of Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels. In fact, communists, not least in the West, looked to the Soviet Union as the exemplary society they wanted to establish in the West. Okay. When the communist system in the Soviet Union collapsed, along with their satellites in Eastern Europe, the national order collapsed. Not only did we witness a fall of society, but also the breakdown of an ideology. This is, however, not an undisputed claim. There are many who argue that the Soviet society and its allies perverted the Marxist ideology. But is that really so? Leszek Kolakowski, an eminent professor of philosophy of Polish origin, deals with this in his formidable three-volume study of Marxism and concludes by saying, and I quote, "It would be absurd to maintain that Marxism was, so to speak, the efficient course of the present-day communism. On the other hand, communism is not a mere degeneration of Marxism, but a possible interpretation of it, and even a well-founded one. Though primitive and partial in some respects, Marxism was a combination of values which proved incompatible for empirical, though not for logical reasons, so that some could be realized only at the expense of others," quote, end of quote. From the above, it's obvious that the order created in the Soviet Union and later in the satellite states of Eastern Europe was based on the foundations of Marxist ideology. And the reasons for the collapse of the social order of the communist states lay in that ideology. The great limits on ownership of private property and the central planning of the economy were not sustainable. This system led to stagnation and irrational decision-making because the great economic plans and centralized top-down decision-making were not able to create a strong economic foundation. Societies are in its nature pluralistic, and even the most detailed plans are never able to grasp the dynamic nature of societies. Every economy includes a variety of visible and concealed messages which individuals transmit knowingly and unknowingly about their needs and abilities. In a centralized society, this is dealt with by central planning. In the capitalist society, this occurs through the mechanism of the free market. There are those who believed that modern-day computers and technology could imitate the market and thus a socialist society based upon economic planning would prevail. History proved them wrong. And this most evidently undermined the communist economy, resulting in its poor economic performance. The socialist ideology of central planning and disregard of the market economy was therefore the major cause of the economic backwardness of the communist states of the Soviet Union and the satellite countries. This was the reason why Poland, formerly a prosperous agricultural economy, lagged behind. This was the reason why Estonia, formerly on equal footing with Denmark, failed, and why Western Germany far exceeded the GDR in its economic performance. The despotic characteristics of the former communist countries were also inevitable. As Professor Kolakowski phrases it, and I quote, "The idea of perfect equality, i.e. an equal share of all goods for everybody, is not only unfeasible economically, but is contradictory in itself. For perfect equality can only be imagined under a system of extreme despotism, but despotism itself presupposes inequality, at least in such basic advantages as participation in power and access to information. In real life, more equality means more government, and absolute equality means absolute government," end of quotation. Viewing it from its perspective, it should have been obvious and inevitable that the socialist societies would eventually fail. And in all fairness, it should be acknowledged that numerous scholars, politicians, intellectuals, and others claimed so. As early as in 1922, the Austrian economist Ludwig von Mises predicted the unsustainability and eventual collapse of the Soviet system in his book, Socialism, an Economic and Sociological Analysis. And in 1970, the prominent Soviet dissident Andrei Amalarik wrote his widely acclaimed and influential book, Will the Soviet Union Survive Until 1984? And that was written in 1970. I would like to cite a short passage from that book which influenced me at the time and many of my generation, and I quote, "There is another powerful factor which works against the chance of any kind of peaceful reconstruction and which is equally negative for all levels of society. This is the extreme isolation in which the regime has placed both society and itself. This isolation has not only separated the regime from society and all sectors of society from each other, but also put the country in extreme isolation from the rest of the world. The isolation has created for all, from the bureaucratic elite to the lowest social levels, an almost surrealistic picture of the world and of their place in it. Yet the longer the state of affairs helps to perpetuate the status quo, the more rapid and decisive will be the collapse when confrontation with reality becomes inevitable," end of quotation. But despite all this, the fall of the Berlin Wall caught the world by surprise, as Mr. Ásgrímsson just referred to earlier. The Soviet bloc was perceived as a superpower, as it apparently was in military terms and judging from its political influence at a global scale. That fact was presumably deceived both analysts and political leaders in the West and made them believe that the collapse of the Soviet bloc was far from imminent. In the late 1980s, however, it had become apparent that the level of discontent within the Soviet bloc had risen, the failed oppression of the solidarity movement by Polish authorities in addition to Gorbachev perestroika were signals of different policies departing from the traditional authoritarian rule of the communist leader. By the summer of 1989, socialist fraternity was fraying badly, and Hungary was no longer willing to act as a gatekeeper once Budapest party leaders allowed East Germans to exit to Austria in September 1989. The final act of the GDR tragedy began. The cracks in the socialist blocs were becoming ever more apparent. What is, however, interesting to note is the fact that this came about as a relatively peaceful process. The Soviet and socialist power evidently had become so crippled that it dissolved before the eyes of the mankind as seen through the lenses of the media at the time. The fall of the Berlin Wall has become the image most people connect with the collapse of communism in Europe. It was an event that changed history, even if the Soviet Union staggered on for 2 years from the memorable October days in Berlin in 1989. However, after the wall had been transformed overnight from the Iron Curtain, the question was not whether European communism was going to breathe its last breath, but when. But where are we now? a quarter of a century after the historical events. This question is a theme in the essay Normal Countries, the East 25 Years After Communism by Andrei Schleifer and Daniel Treisman, published in the most recent edition of Foreign Affairs publication. They contest the idea of the former communist countries as failed states, as often is referred to, pointing out that despite difficult transition, most indicators show remarkable progress, whether in terms of the environmental improvement, economic growth, car ownership, travel, university enrollment, food quality or consumption, to just give a few examples. The Brussels-based Bruegel Institute reached the same conclusion in a recent study, indicating that many Eastern European capitals are now at a level or even with higher GDP per capita than established Western capitals. The former communist countries' transition to market economies has been far from painless, but the results are in many ways astonishing. They have managed to create freer, more liberal economies than many of the old capitalist countries, with low tax levels, less red tape, and low debt levels. But regional differences still exist within the countries of Eastern Europe, as in fact with every country of the world. Differences in income and employment levels between the eastern and western parts of Germany still exist, as we know, although they are much less than before the fall of the wall. And it's perhaps unrealistic to expect the same level of economic performance and equal income levels, at least in the near future. The historical difference in the economic performance between the industrialized Bundesländer in the West and other regions has existed for a longer period than the rule of communism in the former GDR. But what is important to acknowledge is the increased sense of national unity, not least within the younger generation. Finally, and to conclude, I would like to welcome the initiative taken by the Institute of Cultural Diplomacy to host this event, commemorating 25 years since the fall of the Berlin Wall, reuniting the people of Germany and liberating the citizens of the former GDR from decades of oppression. We must never forget the importance of that event. The fall of the Berlin Wall will remain in our minds as a symbol of the fall of a socialist empire and the bankruptcy of an ideology. Thank you very much for your attention.